Good morning, and wonderful to be here with you for the first part of your deliberations today. I come very much as an ally in everything that you're trying to do through RTRS. As you just heard, I've been involved for the last decade or more through my organization, Forum for the Future, working closely with large palm oil companies in Malaysia, Indonesia and elsewhere, and seeking to accelerate some of the solutions that are so urgently needed in that industry to deliver sustainable solutions for the world today. So I've learned a lot from that work, I have to say. And from it, I've become a very strong supporter of corporate leadership in these multi-stakeholder initiatives. It can't be done without that corporate leadership. And NGOs today, realistically, would be the first to acknowledge that all the good work that the NGOs do can only really deliver the outcomes they seek if it can be associated with corporate leadership of that kind. Secondly, I'm a very strong supporter of certification schemes. Okay, so palm, as you know, through the Roundtable on Sustainable Palm Oil. Now, it was once a given in the world of civil society that certification schemes of these kind were a good thing and that we should all be supportive. Well, that is no longer the reality. There are more and more critics and outspoken critics today of certification schemes of every kind. I've just been dealing with a particular instance of this in the palm industry, where an organization called the Changing Markets Foundation brought out a new piece of work, essentially seeking to demolish the usefulness of the RSPO and other certification schemes in terms of providing consumers with the assurances that they need about more sustainable production systems. They never quite say what the alternative to certification schemes might be, but they're very vocal in their contempt for them. I have little time for these critics. I'm also a very strong supporter of taking a systems-wide perspective on all of these difficult wicked issues. You know, to me, in the 10 years that I've spent working with the palm oil industry, I honestly can't remember a single occasion where I heard a Western NGO, by which I mean European or US-based NGO, ever acknowledge for a single second the socioeconomic benefits that that industry had brought to countries like Malaysia, Indonesia, Papua New Guinea, and so on. I was concerned as the next person about deforestation and the environment. But if you don't take into account a wider perspective, what makes you think that anyone is ever going to listen to you as a bona fide stakeholder in such complex matters? Equally, and perhaps even more astonishing, in this joined up global economy, I've never heard one of those Western NGOs talk about the knock-on effects if we were to transition substantively out of the use of palm oil into other vegetable edible oils. The campaign remains the same. Reduce demand for, or even eliminate the use of palm oil in as many different manufacturing or processing possibilities as one can find. Very, very rarely do you hear people acknowledge what the knock-on impacts of that substitution story would be. Huge impacts on every other competitor oil. Talk about oils now, not meal. Rapeseed, canola, soybean oil, of course. can't remember a time where people link substitution out of palm oil to what is happening in the Cerrado today. So we have tons of wonderfully enthusiastic, active advocates for the forests, for an improved environment, for reduced emissions, for thinking more about climate change, who seem to have such a limited grasp on system-wide effects that you wonder sometimes what they're doing in their spare time. So I do enormously admire the work of the RTRS. I think it is really important. We just heard about how much you've achieved during the course of your existence, what your ambitions now are, and how to build on the achievements that you've already had, which by your own acknowledgement are not as great as you would want so far, and having a limited impact on this vast, heaving global industry, the soybean industry. These achievements are significant, strong standard that people can buy into, perhaps a little too complicated as I hear from some people. A very large number of growers, more than 30,000 producers growers, contributing to the scheme now. Supportive retailers who clearly want the RTRS to thrive, and a rising ambition to become an agent for much more transformative change in the industry as a whole. So there is a really important shared common endeavor here, which is the baseline for success in all initiatives of this kind, especially when we are up against so many incredible barriers to success in this area. I'm going to address some of those barriers in a moment, but the trouble is, most of the barriers we face are not specific to your industry, to the soybean industry. They're endemic in our particular model of capitalism. If we've developed a model of capitalism during the course of which people have learned how to externalize cost, dump cost onto the environment, onto communities, onto people, onto future generations, business has got very good at legalized cost externalization. It's the norm. It's not the exception. It's the norm. Where you can legally take that cost off your own P&L and dump it onto somebody else's. Why wouldn't you in this particular model of shareholder first, profit maximizing capitalism? That puts a disproportionate importance on competitiveness, where the only competitiveness that really matters is when you look at your performance relative to the performance of other companies in that sector, regardless of competitiveness beyond that. All competitiveness is between one product, one source of product, and another. And yet we don't really go down into these deep, difficult, and dark issues. If you just think for a single moment about the biggest blocker for 100% genuinely sustainable soybean across the global economy. It probably won't even come up in your deliberations over the next 2 years. But the greatest single blocker is the absolute insistence on cheap meat. Driving the cost of meat in all forms, whether it's beef, chicken, pork, whatever it might be, driving down the cost of meat so that governments, retailers, manufacturers can keep on saying, we're doing the best possible job to bring you cheap meat. I'm honestly not sure that in a world where cheap meat is seen to be more important than a sustainable future, that RTRS would ever be able to deliver on some of its ambitions. So those deep issues are then compounded by certain problems in the soybean industry as a whole. compounded by legacy issues, and let's face it, there are some deep legacy issues here. I have rarely come across an industry with such a chronic lack of transparency at practically every level. Now, this lack of transparency demonstrably suits some players in the value chain much more than it does others. And you will all know what I'm talking about here. This reluctance to embrace the full value of transparency in supply chains holds back this industry from doing what it now needs to do. I think sometimes it would be useful to call out those who benefit so egregiously from this lack of transparency, and to invite them to join a rather more progressive picture of what stakeholder and consumer expectations look like today in the 21st century. Call out the blockers. Call out the high priests of the lowest common denominator, because to be honest, they do your industry no favors whatsoever. But then we're also facing a world of really extraordinary complacency, given where we now are. And I'm just going to, if I may, share with you a tiny little insight into the extent of this complacency, not because I see an audience like this, a group of people like this, as being in any way detached from the reality of what is happening to the world today, but because sometimes, even if we are following these issues and these debates, we don't really quite understand how much of our burning platform has already been burnt out. So just a few little reminders of where we are today. You'll be very familiar with this, obviously. You know what's happening out there in the world today. Every single climate scientist will tell you the same thing. Every indicator of the impact of climate change in today's world is moving faster everywhere in the world. There is no exception. There is no countervailing set of facts to put against that. You will also know what that means for the future of agriculture as a whole, and in particular for the future of soils. These statistics, I presume, form part of the backdrop for all of you as responsible producers in the world today. They're well known. They're promulgated by governments, by the Food and Agriculture Organization. They're not hidden. They're not the product of slightly insane non-governmental organizations. This is the scientific consensus on which modern agriculture continues to make its model work. The FAO, 18 months ago, came out with a report saying that things don't change quickly. In many parts of the world, there will be no more than 60 years of viable harvest at the current rate of depletion of soils. We're just talking today about a couple of these systems. You probably know this work done by the Stockholm Resilience Center, looking at all of the big picture planetary boundaries, 9 planetary boundaries. Climate, biodiversity, a story about what's happening in the upper atmosphere, aerosols, climate change itself, etc., etc. This is an incredible picture that we are looking at today. And I'm sure you will have guessed very quickly that the safe operating space in which humankind needs to find itself if it wants to continue to thrive is more and more at risk as we move out of the safe operating space into the yellow zone, where it's still not too late to bring things back, but it's getting pretty difficult, and out into the red zone. And here we're talking about biological integrity, about impact on biodiversity. So when you next think about 50% of the Cerrado having already disappeared, don't just think about that as a one-off issue. It isn't a one-off issue. It's part and parcel of a much, much bigger picture. We're already way, way outside any notion of what a safe operating zone would be for humankind. This one's pretty important to your industry. Biogeochemical flows, nitrogen, phosphorus largely. Again, we're completely out of balance with everything we know about how nitrogen cycles through the natural economy. This is now our physical reality. And every year, without exception, every year, it gets worse. I'm going to spend 3 minutes unpacking this little slide for you, just to remind you that the debate about climate change today is not where you think the debate about climate change is. This is an extremely useful piece of work done by an organization called Carbon Group Brief, which assesses the total amount of greenhouse gases that we can continue to put into the atmosphere and at the same time stay within a stable climate, a safe operating space for humankind as defined by our stable climate. And what we've simply done is to say, if you want to stabilize average temperature increases at no more than 1.5 degrees centigrade by the end of the century, here are the statistical probabilities of how long we've got to do that, or 2 degrees centigrade, or 3 degrees centigrade. Now, I'm not going to give you a little lecture on climate change today, but I'm sure that you all know the difference between stabilizing at no more than 1.5 degrees centigrade by the end of the century, and stabilizing at 2 degrees centigrade by the end of the century is the difference between a habitable planet and a good future for humankind, and an increasingly inhabitable planet and much more disruptive future for humankind. So here are the odds. I'm sure there'll be a few better people in the audience here today. If we want to stay within that 1.5% boundary, which all the world scientists have signed up to, all the world governments have signed up to, and you were happy to accept a kind of statistical probability that we could do it with 66% of the climate not running away, we would have precisely 4 years left to make the necessary changes. If anyone in this audience thinks we're going to do that, you're mad. Perhaps you don't want such dodgy odds as that. So maybe even if you took something like this, go for a third. 30% probability of having a stable climate at 1.5%, then you would still only have 15 years. Nobody really tracks this. People think they've kind of got to the point of awareness they need to be at when they've stopped denying the reality of climate change and they've taken it upon themselves to criticize climate deniers. That is not enough. We have to internalize the speed of change. We have to be better at understanding what this means for this generation, not future generations. Forget that little trope that climate change is something that will impact on future generations. This is for us right now in all of our lives. Now, I don't want to be too gloomy, there's lots going on. I'm not going to talk about this very much as we are short of time this morning, inevitably. But we are beginning to hear more and more about this notion of regenerative agriculture. Production systems put more back into the environment and into society than they extract or take from it. And you will be quite familiar with many of the different aspects, emerging aspects, of what regenerative agriculture looks like. It is an extraordinarily exciting area. And I just want to exhort all of you, when you think about the efforts that you're making, particularly the growers represented here today, when you think about the efforts that you have to go through to get your crop certified to the RTRS or other standards, your part of a much bigger global movement that is pressing all of these different characteristics. Last comment, using soil as a carbon sink. Okay, let me introduce you to my favorite word at the moment, which is recarbonization. Now, I have no doubt that you've spent many years of your life worrying about the imperative, the urgent need to decarbonize our economies. The other side of that coin is the need to recarbonize our soils. Because we cannot do what we need to do to slow the impact of climate change without protecting and rebuilding stores of CO2 in the world's soils. We can't do it. That, by the way, is not academic for any of you in this room, when you bear in mind one of the principal data points surfaced through the Cerrado Manifesto, which is that the Cerrado itself sequesters around 13.7 billion tons of CO2. So what an extraordinary moment for you to be spending 2 days together to think of ways of enhancing your own effectiveness, accelerating what you're doing, increasing its impact. And I just have 4 tiny little reminders of how this might look. Firstly, embrace the value of becoming a purposeful talk shop. I hate it when people disparage talk shops as if they weren't worth anything at all. They're worth a lot when they are purposeful talk shops. I contrast those, of course, with what I would call grandstanding talk shops, where people just come together to talk but not actually do anything. And I must admit that I've had my fill of those in the palm oil industry over the last 10 years, not the RSPO, I would say, particularly when they are well populated by somewhat sanctimonious Western retailers and food companies, only too keen to extol the value of sustainable palm in this instance, when everybody knows that they themselves have done next to nothing to turn those fine words into practice. Sure, that isn't the case in the soybean industry, but it gets right up my nose when I detect it in the palm oil industry. Secondly, focus on materiality, the things that really matter. You will have noticed that I've got quite deep into my talk without even mentioning GM so far. I've been a lifetime campaigner against GM, but for different reasons than you might expect. Not because I think GM is inherently wicked or morally flawed, or even that it constitutes massive dangers to human health or even to biodiversity. My opposition is premised on the fact that GM hasn't taken on the whole set of challenges around genuinely sustainable agriculture, around moving towards regenerative agriculture in the way that I just said. GM and non-GM share too great a dependency on unsustainable, intensive production systems, which permit the continuation of soil erosion, soil abuse, as I call it, impacts on biodiversity, water, energy, climate change, etc. Intensively monocropped, non-GM crops have few advantages, it has to be said, over intensively monocropped GM crops. But go to the heart of this debate. The heart of this debate is not GM versus non-GM. The heart of this debate is unsustainable versus regenerative. And that's where we have to look. So I'm pretty nervous about default anti-GM campaigns that seem to gloss over that. And we're going to have a very interesting debate about this in your industry in particular. Particularly when new varieties of high oleic soybean start working their way into the marketplace. And ever since the ban on trans fats in the US and Europe, we will see greater emphasis on the importance of GM to help improve on some of those issues. Thirdly, and I say this with trepidation, knowing the position of some in RTS, don't put too many of your eggs in the basket labeled consumer awareness. Most of this stuff is too complicated. Most consumers, this is controversial, are too indifferent. And connecting the reality of what we're talking about, the genuinely sustainable agronomic systems with what the consumer wants, is really difficult. Start more realistically, perhaps, from the end point. The global consumers are the unknowing beneficiaries of everything that you do, rather than the drivers of the change that is necessary. And that brings me to my final, which is the importance of leadership. The kind of leadership that you demonstrate by being here at a conference like this, by being active supporters of RTRS, by building into your own proposition for your customers that what you're doing here in the name of sustainable soybean production is crucial for you and for the future of the industry. For me, this is an absolute precondition of success in this industry. And I'll end with a tiny little anecdote. When I wrote my last book called The World We Made in 2013, I had a little section in it about deforestation in the Amazon and impact on other vegetation systems, including the Cerrado. Not many people were talking about the Cerrado back in 2013, it has to be said, but you could see the way it was going. Pattern of destruction was always there in front of our noses, even if we didn't know it. I wrote the book from the perspective of 2050. How do we get to be living in a genuinely sustainable world? A good one, a fair one, a compassionate one. By 2050, given all of the difficulties that we face today, how do we actually get from where we are today to that good world? I'm not going to say the best of all worlds, because it won't be, because we've messed up too much so far. But this good world that is available to us by 2050, how do we do that? How do we get there? And how in particular did the soybean industry play its part in that transition? Well, here's an improbable thought for you. It wasn't because of the undiminished campaigning vigor of Greenpeace, wonderful work of WWF with initiatives like the Cerrado Manifesto and so on. It wasn't because of brilliantly far-sighted, honest politicians. As can you imagine, that is an unrealistic utopia. It wasn't because of any of those things. It was because the industry itself recognized for itself that its long-term future depended 100% on bringing its production systems in line with these huge natural forces around soil, around water, around biodiversity, the natural capital on which every productive enterprise ultimately depends. That was what made it happen. That was my most effective voice. This happens after 2020, by the way. The most effective voice, the protection of the Cerrado, continuing protection of the Amazon in Brazil, is the voice of the soybean industry, not the voice